Recorded Books and RB Digital present Insert Groom Here by K.M. Jackson. Narrated by Diana Luke. Chapter 1.
I can't marry you.
Eva Ward knew words were being murmured over her shoulder, but for the life of her, she couldn't quite make them out. The red light above the camera transfixed her, and Kevin's voice sounded like it came from somewhere far away, as if from down a long corridor. To top things off, she was fighting a chill. The temperature in the blasted television studio had to be set at 50 degrees at the highest. Eva thought about the frigid air a moment and hoped the cold didn't show on her face, or, Lord help her, anywhere else on her anatomy. That would be all she needed, for her nipples to make a surprise appearance on national morning television. Eva pushed back a frown as she brought her thoughts back to that blasted red light and Kevin. Okay, focus time. What is he going on about?
I can't marry you, Kevin repeated,
and Eva blinked.
Wait, what?
Wait, what?
Jim Bauer, the morning show's co-host, took Eva's confused thoughts and echoed them out loud, punctuated with his usual everyman laugh. But this was a bad time to laugh. In fact, it was the absolute worst time to laugh.
I don't think we heard you correctly, Kevin. It sounded for a moment like you were calling off the wedding.
Eva fought to keep her smile in place as Kevin turned from her to Jim.
That's right, Jim. I am.
She blinked again as the words really began to sink in.
He is calling off what?
Anger bubbled up, heating Eva more quickly than could possibly be safe. She caught another glimpse of the red light and forced herself to push it back down.
Hold on there. This is not the time to go off the rails, Eva told herself. She could do this.
She'd practiced being on live TV, and she'd been put on the spot plenty of times. She was trained for these moments. Media relations was her job, for Christ's sake. Eva pulled her attention away from the maddening red light that reminded her millions of people were watching this debacle over their morning coffee and toast. Instead, she plastered on a well-trained smile and focused on what her fiancé Kevin and the talk show's co-hosts were now saying. But try as she might, she couldn't wrap her head around the words as they trickled toward her in dribs and drabs.
Something about being confused, Kevin said. Just not the right time, he went on. And wait, did she really hear the words moving too fast? Hold up, this was madness.
It was as if she was having some sort of odd bout of both inner and out-of-body experience, and she couldn't get the two to gel. But she had to, because Kevin was talking about her as if she wasn't there, sitting by his side on TV. National freaking TV. It was time to take control of the situation. Eva blinked again, her lashes feeling thick and gloppy from the extra coats of mascara, plus the individual false lashes the makeup woman had put on her that morning. She had thought they were a bit much at the time. Now she was afraid that with all the ridiculous blinking she was doing, she probably looked like Bambi gone drag. Eva forced her eyes wide, as if that would somehow make her appear saner, and stared at Kevin. Oh, hell, Mr. Smooth was starting to sweat, despite the fact that if it was 2 degrees colder, you'd be able to see your breath as you welcomed Satan into the studio. His sleek, ultra-groomed, dark cocoa skin was starting to glisten, and Eva now noticed a hint of fear in his eyes. Eva's heart raced, but despite this, she caught Kevin's eye and gave him a smile that she hoped said, "Come on, honey, don't lose your cool now," as she reached over and gave his hand a pat. She could do this. Just a little damage control, and she'd reel this right in. Eva turned to her other side and looked at Diane Parker, one of the morning show's other co-hosts, but Diane's blue eyes only seemed to mirror Eva's own internal confusion. Just perfect. No help from Blondie. So Eva turned her gaze to Jim. Good old Jim. Surely Mr. All-America would help save the day. But in that moment, a clear sound finally reached Eva's ears,
punctuated by good old Jim's good old laugh. The loud, false pang rang against her eardrums.
Ha ha! Good one, Kevin, Jim said,
as Eva took in the obvious tension playing around the corners of his mouth, causing some of his pancake makeup to crease.
Of course you're joking.
No, Jim, I'm not, Kevin said,
his voice clear, strong, and surprisingly absolute as he turned Eva's way.
I'm sorry, Eva. I can't go through with this.
Despite her best efforts at bracing, Eva winced as the words penetrated. The full impact hit her like a crosstown bus trying to make up for lost time. This was not happening. It couldn't be happening. Not here, not now, not to her. But Kevin continued, his voice getting higher with each word. The more his lips moved and the words washed over her, the more of a blur he became. His handsome features, smooth skin, close-cropped hair, fine button-down Oxford shirt, new three-button jacket, pocket square, all becoming a washed-out mass of swirly rejection under the bright studio lights. For a moment, Eva felt like she might be sick, so she bent her head, her gaze hitting Kevin's highly polished leather shoes, the ones that she had picked up for him last week so he would be perfect for their big television appearance this morning. Eva felt her chest tighten as her throat squeezed shut.
I really am sorry, babe, but I can't do it. It's all too much, and I've realized I'm not ready to get married.
It was like a physical blow, like he had kicked her in the gut while wearing the shoes she paid for. Eva's head snapped up then, away from the shoes and away from Kevin, too. She saw the camera and the red light as it flashed before her like a beacon. She shut her eyes for a moment and thought once again about how many people watch this while they sipped their morning coffee and ate their sugar-toasted oats. What were they thinking as they stared at the seemingly normal-looking woman in her pink twinset and sharply pleated skirt? Damn it, she was wearing her grandmother's pearls. How does one go about getting dumped in heirloom pearls? The nausea twisted at her again, and Eva had the distinct feeling that her normally caramel-hued skin was probably taking on a green cast to match the bile now churning in her belly. She wondered if the color would be picked up and broadcast in HD. Now there was an ideal breakfast entertainment for you. And then it hit her, and her worry doubled, practically tripled. Shit. Her mother was watching this, watching and most likely fuming. She could imagine the look on Valerie Ward's face right now. She was sure to be yelling into a phone right that moment to have her assistant and the rest of the staff come in early to get started on damage control. The thought sent Eva over the edge. Probably even more than experiencing disappointment herself, she hated the idea of letting her mother down. She'd had enough of that in her life, and though she came off as a human fire breather, Eva knew it was mostly a mask to cover past hurts. Not ready to get married. Kevin's words echoed through Eva's head, along with visions of her mother's impeding tirade, and she felt the heat rise. First, it was a burning in the soles of her feet. Then it licked up her legs, moving on to radiate through her stomach before finally making its way to her face. She paused, her breathing virtually stopping a moment as the stomach churning turned to a full-on boil. Was this bastard really breaking up with her on national television merely months? Hell, practically weeks before her perfectly planned wedding? Eva finally turned and looked at Kevin, fighting hard to keep her emotions in line. She laughed, a belly laugh that would make even old Jim proud. It's a joke. It has to be. Diane and Jim cautiously joined her in the chuckle and bolstered her spirits. Phew. She couldn't believe she'd almost fallen for it. Of course, Kevin would never do that to her. He also had too much riding on this marriage, too much riding on them. It must have been some silly producer thing. They were always doing something to try and jack up the ratings, and she played along and fell for it, for a moment. She should have known it was a stunt. What better fodder for the gossip mill and ratings than an on-air breakup and makeup from America's, at least for the moment, sweetheart couple? But Kevin knew how important this was, how much this wedding meant to her, to them and their future, both personally and professionally. But he had been a fool to go for it in the first place and not let her in on the joke. Eva strained out a smile. "Funny, but come on, sweetie, joke's over," she said. "Now tell me you were just playing." She turned to the camera and raised a perfectly arched brow. "Tell America you were playing. We will be married and have our dream wedding right here on the morning show, courtesy of Tied Knot Style and Bliss." Eva smiled wide. Her mother would appreciate the advertiser tie-in. One never missed out on the opportunity to thank a sponsor. It was a cardinal rule of marketing. Always keep the sponsors happy and coming back to write another check. But instead of laughing with her and getting in on the joke, good old Jim clammed up and flipped through his blue cards, looking confused. And Diane, well, she was still a grinning zero as she nodded in a bobble-headed way that couldn't quite be declared for or against the joke theory. And wait, was that sweat on her brow now, too? Holy hell. Eva looked back at Kevin for reassurance, and he shrugged. The bastard shrugged.
"I really am sorry, Eva. You know I always cared for you."
Cared? Did he say cared? A rock thudded where her heart was supposed to be. Cared, as in what you do for your late grandmother, as in how you felt about your childhood dog. Cared, ED, as in past tense? Kevin turned to the camera and laid on that old Kevin charm, looking ever so innocent and sincere.
I'm sorry, America. I'd like to apologize to you too, and this is not Eva's fault. It's all me.
Jim piped in.
Well, I'm not really sure what to say here. We'll take a commercial break and be right back.
He then held his ear and with an awkward look turned to Eva.
I really am sorry. It seems we can't go to commercial. Not for 90 more seconds.
Jim gave Eva a look that said,
tough break, kid.
Eva bit her lip and tried to steady her breathing. Since her heart was beating so hard and fast, she was sure the mics must be picking up every erratic thump. Crap! In 90 seconds, she was sure to be dead from humiliation. Diane shifted her eyes away before speaking to the camera. Her voice took on a funereal tone.
We are truly sad to hear of this development. We were all looking forward to your wedding. But I guess now, given the circumstances, and as per the rules of the competition, we'll have to choose another couple.
Diane smiled and changed her voice on a dime.
Luckily, we still have Sherry and Brad from Des Moines, who are our runner-up couple. Hey, as they say, it's for the best to find out before the marriage that the two of you don't suit, don't you think?
Just perfect. It's now that she turns into a freaking all-star chatterbox, spouting rules and crap. No. The word came out before Eva could stop to think about what she was saying.
Excuse me?
Diane asked, her wispy brows drawing together.
Maybe you didn't hear what Kevin said. He does not want to marry you.
Eva shot Diane a look that said, thanks, but no thanks for the clarification. Then turned back to Kevin as he piped up again.
Yes, Eva.
Kevin put his hand across her forearm.
What are you talking about? I said I won't marry you. There won't be a wedding.
He rubbed his hand gently across her forearm. Eva looked down at it, not knowing if it was supposed to be comforting or controlling. It didn't matter. It wasn't either. She looked up at him, eyes blazing, and jerked her arm away. Then, catching the red light out of the corner of her eye, Eva thought briefly of her mother, before giving Kevin a huge smile that would probably make the most venomous snake proud.
I don't give a damn what you said.
I will have my wedding with or without you. It was like a fire had ignited and was rushing through her veins, threatening to burn out of control. Kevin pulled back, shaking his head.
Eva, come on, stop, you're not making sense.
Then he lowered his voice to a stage whisper, as if the mic still couldn't pick him up.
Plus, you're embarrassing yourself.
For the second time that morning, Eva laughed inappropriately on national TV.
Goody, maybe hysterics are setting in.
She supposed it was natural, given the circumstances.
Oh, really? Tell me, how can I embarrass myself any more than you already have? Freaking all of America is watching my national dumpation.
She waved her hands wildly in a gesture to the studio. Beyond them, there were multiple cameras and overhead lights, and you could see the silhouettes of the burly cameramen nodding their heads in the distance. Behind Eva, Jim, Diane, and Kevin was a large window with people jockeying for their moment of fame, holding up signs saying hi to Mom. Eva blew a guy in a cheese hat a kiss when he made an obscene gesture toward his crotch. She turned back to Kevin and nodded.
See there? I'm already fielding promising offers.
A mumble of laughter traveled throughout the studio. Kevin looked down at the floor. Coward. She should have known he wasn't up to the challenge when she had to push him to retake the bar exam. No, he was ready, after one little setback, to squander it all and spend his life living between her couch and his rich stepfather's bungalow, making it party-hopping off his good looks and charm. Well, no more. Eva jabbed a finger into his chest, and Kevin looked back up. This time, satisfaction nipped at her as she saw a glimmer of anger in his eyes.
6 years. I have wasted 6 years dealing with your wishy-washy indecisiveness. And here we are, about at the finish line, and you go and back out now. Stopping in the fourth quarter? Eighth inning? On the last lap? What kind of man are you? Well, I'll tell you. You're the type to use up all the best years a woman has, and then when it's time to commit, you bail.
As she said the words, she felt a lump form in her throat and tears well in her eyes. Oh, hell no. There was no way she would let that happen. No way would she let Kevin know he'd gotten to her. She swallowed and then continued.
Well, I've got news for you. There are plenty of men who I'm sure would be happy to take your place. Just ask Cheesehead.
Eva looked back to the window, but Cheesehead was gone. She guessed the cheese was fine, but apparently pointing out your sausage was a bit much for morning TV. She turned back to Kevin and continued.
No matter. I will still have my wedding. You are replaceable. The question is, who's got next? I will have my wedding, and I'll have it on the date as planned.
She pointed to the empty spot beside her.
All I have to do is just insert groom here.
It was then that Eva detected a murmur going through the studio. Oh, crap. Did she really say what she had just said out loud? She looked up and saw the red light flashing like a beacon out to New York, Chicago, Iowa, and beyond. And did she really just say it to not only Kevin, but to Jim, Diane, and the rest of America? Eva closed her eyes.
Oh, God, please make this a bad dream. It has to be.
But when she opened them and focused on everyone around the studio, the same people who had smiled at her with admiration moments ago were all staring at her now like she was the Wicked Witch of the West or someone ready for a straitjacket.
Shit, this dream is way too real.
Panicked, Eva jumped off the raised stool, pushing back sharply. She heard it crash to the ground behind her as she ran off the set.
Well, that was spirited. We'll be right back, folks. And in our next half hour, bringing romance back into the kitchen.
The irony of Jim's words almost had Eva cringing as they echoed through the studio's speakers. His ridiculous ha-ha-ha laugh kept time with the clanking of Eva's retreating heels. Chapter 2.
Shit, shit, shit!
Eva couldn't stop herself from kicking the worn leather couch in the studio's surprisingly not at all green room. And if she had thought about it for more than 15 seconds, then, well, she probably could have stopped herself. That is, if she really had wanted to. But the physical release of her anger felt too damned good. It felt new. It felt real. It felt free. So she turned and banged her fists against the wall without a care for her hands, then regretted it as hot pain shot up through her arm. Freaking hell! Add that to her list of dumb moves of the morning. Funny, though not even, it never looked that painful on TV.
Ugh!
She let out a hard, unladylike grunt. The thought of TV instantly brought the scene she'd just escaped from back to her mind. Who the hell breaks up with someone on national TV? But worse, who flips out like she did? Eva sucked in a breath. What was she thinking? She never lost her cool and went off like that. At least, not so publicly. If there was one thing she knew, it was the value of keeping her true emotions hidden. But then Kevin's nonchalant shrug came back to the forefront of her mind, and once again, without thinking, Eva went for the wall. Like Kevin, the wall won.
Damn! It!
Eva looked down at her red, quickly swelling knuckles and winced.
And damn you, Kevin, you piece of crap, spineless betrayer.
If he wanted to do the breakup in a public place, why couldn't he pick a Starbucks like a normal human being? Eva felt a hot tear fall and swiped it away. She didn't even know why she was crying. In the moment, it certainly wasn't over love lost or any such nonsense. She didn't have time for that type of bull. Not that she didn't care for Kevin. Sure she did. If she didn't, she wouldn't have put so much time and energy into him and their relationship. But now that she thought about it, she guessed it was the betrayal, and worse, the embarrassment that hurt so much. She was sure she didn't deserve it. In their time together, she'd done nothing but raise Kevin's low-performing stock. Sure, she knew she came off at times as a tad cold and had a reputation for being somewhat demanding. And yes, there were some who referred to her as straight-laced, perhaps stuffy for her age. The word uptight may have been bantered around, and probably she should have beat Kevin to the breakup punch when he had the nerve to call her a prude because she wouldn't go all in for some of his kinkier tie-me-up antics in bed. But what did he know? She could get plenty kinky and have just as much fun as any woman if given the right incentive. But lately, he'd been barely any incentive at all. The funny, kind, attentive, okay, maybe he was a little too into video games, guy she'd first met had somehow morphed into this pompous, pocket-square-wearing asshole the world saw dumping her this morning. So the last thing she wanted to do was jump through some sort of fetish hoops when, both inside and outside the bedroom, he was a total bore. But still, the fact remained that she'd stayed and had invested years of time and energy in Kevin for just this moment. Bailing was not an option. As her mother often said, bailing is never an option. Eva sucked in a breath and stilled when the low hum hit her ears. Her cell phone was on vibrate in her purse on the glass coffee table, and it was currently pulsing so much the whole purse did a little shimmy. It was her mother. Without even looking, Eva knew it had to be. Valerie Ward was probably sitting with either her finger or her assistant's finger pressed hard on the redial button at that moment. Suddenly, Eva had the desire to kick the table, just to hear the glass smash. But of course, she didn't. She couldn't. She had to pull herself together, get some control here. Her moment of going full-blown nutter was done and over. Instead, Eva ignored the phone and rested her forehead on the wall, forcing herself to take slow, deep breaths. She'd deal with her mother soon enough. She had to come up with a plan, or they'd come up with one together. Either way, she had to get a handle on what had happened this morning and get started on her own damage control. She'd handled worse for her celebrity clients, and she was a nobody, so this should be easy to handle with a bit of rug sweeping. She just had to step back and look at things objectively. A lump lodged in her throat. Still, it made no sense. She and Kevin were perfect, despite the kinkiness non-compatibility factor, and she had invested the right amount of time and energy into the relationship. More than enough, actually. They were right on track with her plans, and at the age of 28, she was precisely on schedule. On schedule to be Mrs. Kevin Rucker Esquire before age 29. Add a couple of years of them being an it couple about town, and then bam, the first child by 33, and then baby number two by 35. There would be no bar hopping, awkward setups by friends, or code-worded online profiles for her in her mid-30s. She was getting her shit together. Well, to hell with you, Kevin, for totally messing this up. Thoughts of the gorgeous monogram towels she had pre-ordered for their registry with their initials ERK in script on Pima cotton came to her mind. Damn, she really wanted those towels. Had bought into the whole stupid fantasy of them. Well, screw you, Kevin, and your sorry-assed I love yous, Eva yelled as she swiped once more at an errant tear and stomped her foot. Tendrils of her shoulder-length brown hair came undone from her chignon and fell into her eyes. Then she heard it, a slight shuffling of feet that caused Eva to freeze, then turn around. And there he was, right in the doorway, capturing her every sad and desperate move, stood a very tall man, and that was a lot for her to say, since she was 5'9 without her heels. His skin was a burnished tan, mostly natural, though some, she could tell, came from being outdoors in the sun, his worn t-shirt showing the tan line around his muscular biceps. She looked down, and said tee was tucked haphazardly into well-fitting faded jeans. When her eyes came back up to his face, the sexy scruff on his jaw showed he hadn't taken time to shave that morning. Or maybe the past few mornings before coming to work. Work. That was the worst part of it all. His work. Because slung over the top of this man's very broad shoulder was a TV camera. And in that moment, it was trained directly on Eva in all her overly emotional meltdown glory. What the hell are you doing? Eva inwardly cringed as she heard her own voice come out in an unflattering high shriek. Haven't I been humiliated enough? Nothing. Just silence from t-shirt camera dude for one long beat, and then another, as Eva stared at him open-mouthed, waiting for some sort of answer or apology, or at least for him to put the blasted camera down, anything but this blank, emotionless stare. And then he did it. He finally moved. The hunky camera guy's left brow went up, and at the same time, so did his shoulders. They went up, and then they slumped right back down again. Eva took a step back, bumping into the coffee table behind her. Did he just shrug? Hunky freaking body-hugging tee, faded jeans, perfect stubble camera guy looked at her and shrugged. What the total hell? She was having a perfect, full-on meltdown, and he shrugged. This was her second dismissive shrug of the day. Flashbacks of Kevin's casual shrug mere moments ago washed over her, along with even worse images of Kevin's eyes lingering too long on other women's legs and short skirts, or paying special attention and laying on that old Kev charm with any woman with boobs over a C-cup. When she'd catch him, he'd shrug then too, in a, well, boys will be boys, kind of way. Well, she'd had enough of this bullshit. This was her last shrug of the day. She wasn't taking it anymore. Sucking in a deep breath, Eva smoothed her hair as best as she could, then tugged down, straightening her disheveled skirt. She reached toward the table and slung her purse carefully over her shoulder before finally straightening her pearls. Then, churning on pure hate, Eva walked toward him. She couldn't see his full face, since it was half hidden behind the camera that was taking in her supposedly private meltdown. But she did get a closer look now at the challenge in his one sparkling, heavily lidded, dark brown eye. She thought she may have seen that eye, that sexy frame once or twice wander in and out of the studio, but she wasn't sure. Letting her own eyes wander, Eva also caught a hint of a tattoo peeking out from beneath the cuff of his tee. When she looked back to his full lips, they twitched up at one corner. "You find me amusing?" she asked, holding tight to the reins of her control. "Cool. It's nice to see someone getting a chuckle out of this day." "Too bad it is at my expense," she thought. Just like Kevin was probably laughing now. Just like all of the morning show's viewers were probably laughing too. Eva's blood boiled over at the hitch of that too pretty lip and the smug look in his one dark eye. And then everything seemed to go dark. Her world turned to pinpoint tunnel vision as she continued to be propelled forward, only seeing that sparkling eye of his and that twitching lip. And as if on autopilot, Eva bit her own lip, gave it a light lick. At the last moment, she put a freshly manicured hand up to the front of the camera's lens and watched as Mr. Hunk quickly shifted his head from behind the camera and looked at her, hitting her with the full force of his masculine beauty. Bam! Smooth skin, dark slashes of brows, a strong square jaw, and those full, generously curved lips made her mouth instantly water. She saw him begin to open those lips in protest over her hand on his camera, but before he could get a word out, Eva moved in and covered his mouth with her own, capturing him in a hard, searing kiss. His lips were at first firm and unyielding, but after a few seconds, she felt a shift when they went soft and pliant as her pressure was returned. Then he surprised her by kissing her back. Instantly, Eva was swept up in a haze. It was a sensual fog of her own making, and in that moment, she felt herself swept up on a soft ocean breeze as her body seemed to awaken and come to life like never before. A slow wave of dangerous pleasure washed over her, and then, wham! The wave broke as if hitting a sharp rock when awareness struck, bringing Eva back to herself. She pulled away, making a quick assessment of herself and the situation. Quirking her own lip in a half smile, she looked into camera guy's dark chocolate-colored eyes and saw his expression change from amused to confused. And as Eva looked deeper and briefly lower, she could see he was aroused. Her gaze shifted. He still held tight to the camera high on his broad shoulders, though. That freaking camera, the cause of all her humiliation. Well, that and Kevin, of course. Kevin and his shrug. But Kevin was not there. So Eva focused on camera dude and gave him what she hoped was a saucy wink, then swiftly raised her right knee, slamming it hard and fast between his widespread legs. For a moment, she felt bad. Only for a moment. That one went out to all the shruggers. It was satisfying. And now she was amused by the sound of his weak yelp as he doubled over in pain and made his way to the floor. "Next time, you'll ask permission before you go around filming people like some type of new-age peeping Tom. And you'll think before you shrug," she silently added. She was not one to be screwed with or dismissed. Now if only Kevin were around to get the next knee to the balls. With that, Eva pivoted on the toe of her red-bottomed heels and walked down the hall, turning right at the end and out the studio door with her head held high and straight into the blinding light of dozens of flashing bulbs. Oh, crap. This morning just kept getting better and better. Chapter 3. As Aidan Walker sank to the floor, all he could think was he hoped he didn't black out from the pain radiating throughout his groin. because he was really enjoying the view of her walking away. Still, on the way down, nice view or not, through his pain-blurred eyes, he found it hard to focus on the sway of his assailant's slim hips as she took her long, confident strides down the studio's corridor. He shifted against his poorly timed, hardening erection as searing heat hit him anew, flaming through his body, licking at all the wrong spots. "Shit, shit, shit," he muttered through closed eyes, then paused. Wasn't that what she'd said, not 3 minutes ago, as her on-air humiliation hit her? And to think, he actually had felt a smidge of sympathy for her when that asshole had publicly jerked her over in the studio. Aidan shook his head. This was what he got for letting his guard down. He, more than anyone, knew never to let your guard down. Letting your guard down only led to trouble. At worst, it could get your ass shot off, or at near worst, your balls repositioned somewhere near your throat. All were lessons he should have learned from his last failed assignment overseas. He shifted again as the ache in his groin subsided, and the now more intense pain of humiliation began to set in. Damn. He hadn't been caught off guard like that since his early days on assignment. But come on, how is he supposed to expect a low blow like that from the prim, straight-laced package that was Eva Ward? And he sure as hell wasn't expecting that kiss. Subconsciously, he licked his lips, still tasting the lingering hint of sweetness from her tongue. His dick throbbed in response, and pain flared anew. Holy fuck! She sure was some piece of work. Talk about fire and ice. And she had the nerve to taste like honey and whipped cream. Aidan narrowed his eyes, forcing himself to see things objectively. But there was no reading that woman. The kneeing and the kiss both came out of left field. She was an enigma, and it was damned frustrating since Aidan prided himself on being able to read people. Hell, as a reporter, it was his job. In the time he'd been watching her, he'd thought he'd had her pegged, and now it seemed he was all wrong. Not that he'd been watching her any further than his job of observing a subject required. He knew how important staying detached was, and not that she was even one of his subjects. She was no more than an intrigue that caught his eye on the way to fulfilling his obligations. Still, he could admit the jam to his balls, no matter how painful, sparked his interests even more. She didn't strike him as the type, all buttoned up as she was with her sweater set in pearls. No way, or he never would have stood there like he did, all open and wide-legged and stupidly self-assured, ridiculously sure that he knew her next move. Aidan couldn't help the chuckle escaping his lips. Man, his father would laugh his smug ass off if he could see him now. This was just the sort of situation that proved his point when he'd taken him off field investigations. Women were always the walker downfall. Women, and leaping before one looked. He'd always said that Aidan was too impulsive, and this little episode was just another thing to add to his outtakes. For a moment, Aidan thought of Kate Harmon, his sometimes, well, now former, partner on assignment and in adventure, both in bed and out. Kate would probably shake her head at him too, seeing him on the floor as he was. And any laughter on her part would be well-deserved, any censure too. In the beginning, Kate had liked his impulsiveness. Like most of the women before her, it was a draw. But that sort of thing got old quick, especially when there was more than passion on the line. Turns out, when things got dangerous, Kate wasn't as cut out for the adventurous life as she'd let on. Not that Aidan blamed her. Kate was ready to settle down, and after it got too dicey on that last assignment, well, it was Kate's last straw. Hey, he got it. It was perfectly normal for a young 30-something to get bit by the marriage-slash-mommy bug when she was looking into the eyes of death and being held for ransom. Just then, telling a story might not have seemed all that important compared with getting back home and starting to live the quiet, carefree life portrayed on TV between the peak hours of 8 and 10 p.m. Aidan blamed himself for the mess he'd made of that last assignment and the danger he'd gotten his crew into. He'd screwed that up royally and should have had a better handle on things. He should have been able to read their informant better. He was always a pretty good people reader, and there was no way that one should have slipped past his radar. No matter her watery green eyes and sincere story of endangered children, he'd messed up, didn't do the proper checks, and they'd paid the price. His lesson? Be sharper, work with a smaller team, and avoid entanglements. That way, all the risks would be his own. He should have learned after all these years to never get too close to a story, or to a team anyway. So all in all, Kate was smart getting out. She had decided the life wasn't for her, and subsequently, neither was he. She'd pulled out of the relationship as soon as she was back stateside, taking an anchor job in the Midwest and an engagement ring from an old flame that came along with it. Aidan couldn't blame her at all for choosing the road more traveled. He could only congratulate her. Besides, they'd gotten what they both needed out of their time spent together. At least Kate was honest when the time came to say goodbye. There was no subterfuge from her, and for that, he was grateful. Suddenly, Aidan's mind shifted back to the matter and pain at hand, unlike Little Miss Double Punch with the kick to the groin after a kiss to harden him well and good. That was low, and he'd had his fair share of low blows. The kneeing and the kiss both came out of left field. She was an enigma, and it was damned frustrating. In the time he'd been watching her, he'd thought he had her pegged, and now it seemed he was all wrong. Aidan knew he never should have been so quick to go off running after the lovely Miss Ward without thinking of the consequences. And damn Carter for playing right to his weakness, inviting him down when he did to watch the segment. If he'd given it more than a moment's thought, he might get suspicious. But no. She was blindsided. Still, Carter knew he was always one to run toward the story. It was his biggest failing as well as his greatest asset. Though it was what had also gotten him into hot water on his last assignment, and what now had him back at home instead of out in the field, where he worked best, reporting on the stories that really mattered. But now he was here, where his father thought he was safest, playing corporate desk jockey and living up to the Walker name, getting the full lay of the studio land. At least for the moment, it calmed his father, gave his on-edge nerves a rest, and kept him off Aidan's back. His father still got worked up thinking of Aidan's last dangerous assignment, said it was time for him to play it safe stateside, get a handle on the business, and prepare to take over for him when he was gone. Aidan snorted at that thought. As if the old goat would ever go anywhere or give up the reins to the likes of him. But still, he could play nice, at least for a while, until he could get on the road again. The stories he had to tell were too important to stay home chained to a desk full time. And honestly, the way he saw it, even if he was sidelined for a bit, he could use that time to work his angle from the inside out. Shift the story from crap, like this overdone wedding spectacle, to something that really mattered. Aidan shifted again and groaned. He couldn't believe it. He had made it out of some of the most terrifying places on Earth, only to come home to New York and be easily taken down by an ice princess in pearls. There were some who would find this comical. Some. Over the past few weeks, while she had cunningly duked it out with the other couples for a shot at an on-air wedding, Eva Ward had expertly answered all the right questions and smiled at just the right times, all the while never letting a hair get out of place. No, he definitely wasn't expecting the kick from the tall, slim woman with the well-manicured, well, everything. But maybe he should have been. She looked like she couldn't hurt a fly, let alone maim a man. But as he knew all too well, looks could be deceiving. That morning, he was having fun, joking with some of the veteran camera guys while observing what was happening on the set. It was all a part of his father's plan. Work from the ground up, take in a little of all the key network shows in the major time slots, and then see where he could best fit in. And this part, he didn't mind at all. At least doing this, he wasn't chained to a desk, or worse, stuck in a boardroom. Also, the crew got to know him and would not just see him as the big guy's son. The one who would, deserving or not, probably inherit it all. And as a bonus, he got to be in the background, watching the action, what action there was, and could keep an eye on Miss Ward, as it were. She wasn't hard to watch. Over the weeks, despite the syrupy crap this silly marriage puff piece was, Aidan had found himself either down on the set, hanging in the background, or glued to one of the many screens placed around the offices at just the right time to catch her segment and see every beautiful, perfectly thought-out move she made. The woman was made for TV. But that morning, he felt for her on some sort of deep emotional level. Maybe it was because for the first time he'd seen a crack in her perfectly polished facade. And yes, maybe he should have pulled back, used some of that power that he didn't like to use, and gone over everyone's head when he saw how things were going down, and get Carter to get the director to cut and get her off the hook. Staunch the bleeding in the studio before it became a full-on bloodbath. But no, he had to go and be him. And instead, he had let the story play out, let her get stripped bare for the whole world to see. Then, to top it all off, when she'd run off the set, he'd done the unthinkable and grabbed a camera and gone off running after her. Aidan let out a sigh at his feeble attempt to come up with an excuse. No, this was all on him. He was the one drawn to her. He was the one who had documented her meltdown. And he was the one who had grabbed the camera and eagerly followed behind her when she ran from the studio. His, well, her, only saving grace was that they'd cut to commercial and then the cooking segment and didn't feed back into him while she was in the green room. Small mercies, but still he was grateful. Though he knew that exposés and gotcha journalism were what passed for news nowadays, he'd seen what it could do to a person's life and didn't want that for her. Aidan let out a low curse. Hell, maybe he did deserve a payback for what he'd done. Not a kick to the balls, mind you, but that shrug he had given was a little over the top. Who wouldn't be pissed about being filmed while having a fit like the one she'd had? He smiled then at the memory of her meltdown. Despite it all, she did look kind of cute, going wild like she did with her smooth black hair coming loose and that flush of color rising up, bringing a glow to her creamy tan cheeks, that spark of fire rearing up in those dark cinnamon eyes. Aidan groaned as something too close to desire flamed inside him again. He couldn't help it. The image of her ranting and out of control was so polar opposite from the straight-laced Miss Perfect thing she dished out each time she'd sailed into the studio for the couple's elimination rounds. He couldn't stop watching her, even if he tried. And truth be told, something nagging at him made him want to see more. Though he was ashamed to admit it, he liked seeing her come undone. Maybe it was because it was almost unnerving the way she didn't get her feathers ruffled like the rest of the contestants did. The way she handled every question like a pro. It was damn near bordering on robotic, and for some reason, it grated on his nerves. Which was ridiculous, because what should he care about a buttoned-up ice princess like her? But hell, not even when it was the blindfolded bake-off, definitely not Carter's brightest idea, did she let her hair fall out of place. That was some kind of cool, and at the same time, some weird shit. The woman was unflappable. At least she was until today. Today, after her jerko fiance gave her that on-air sucker punch, she had good and well lost it. And for the first time, he saw a glimpse of her that made him want to look further, go deeper, made him want to reach out and touch her, see if that cold-as-ice exterior could thaw, and if there was actual flesh and blood underneath. Aidan grinned.
Oh yeah, she thawed all right.
And if that kiss was any indication of how she did her thawing out, well, he was all for it.
What are you doing down there, man? And why are you grinning like an idiot? I'm sure when your father told you to get acquainted with all aspects of the station, sweeping the floor with your face wasn't one of them.
At the interruption of his thoughts, Aidan lost his thin grip on humor and shifted his gaze to study the pointy tips of Carter Bain's high-shined loafers.
She kicked me in the balls,
he groaned out to the morning show's segment producer and one of his oldest friends, purposefully omitting the part about the kiss. He didn't have more of a reason for keeping the kiss from Carter, besides there being no reason for Carter to know about it. But Aidan knew in his gut that it went deeper, and if he told Carter, he'd be a dog with a bone, and Aidan wasn't in the mood for a tussle with his old friend. He heard Carter suck in a breath as he barely bit back a chuckle.
Her? No, not her. I knew she was mad, but that mad?
He looked up as Carter shook his head.
Damn! If I knew she was such a loose cannon, I would have stopped you from going after her. Did you get it on camera?
Carter now chuckled out loud.
Of course you did. I can't wait to pull up the footage. Shit, we should have never cut to that stupid cooking segment. I knew she was a spitfire, but I didn't expect her to be that hot.
Aidan raised a brow. Carter was positively gleeful as he turned his body toward the now faraway Miss Ward, who turned the hall's corner. When she disappeared from view, he looked back down toward Aidan and gave him a sly grin. Aidan shook his head. Different day, but still the same old Carter. Here Carter was, despite all hell having broken loose, his segment going to crap, and he still looked cool, smooth, and polished, practically photo shoot ready, and giving a Cheshire cat grin that let Aidan know trouble was soon to follow. Aidan had seen that look from Carter plenty of times over the years and had the battle scars to know what it meant. Carter was working some sort of angle. At times, Aidan couldn't believe this was the same guy he had hung with as a kid, spending every summer day and well into the nights catching waves off Third Point with him and Vin. The three of them trying hard to escape the various limitations and expectations life heaped on three young minority men growing up in the big city. So they'd take their escape where they could and when they could get away, pretending to live carefree lives as beach bums out on the Rockaways, the three amigos. And out of the three of them, it was only Vin who still had any semblance of the carefree beach bum life, riding his bike and catching waves at will, and somehow, in between, making enough money off his beachside taco shack to turn it into a destination sensation and having folks clamoring for more. He turned himself into a renegade chef and business owner. As for Carter, he had ended up getting his MBA and going full tilt corporate, quickly rising in the ranks of World Broadcasting Central, going from production assistant to segment producer in record time. He has been all too happy to use his friendship with Aidan and pull from Aiden's dad to get that first job. From anyone else, the obvious nepotism would have annoyed Aidan, but from Carter, who was blatantly upfront with his bull, it didn't. Besides, it may have been nepotism that got him through the door, but Aidan couldn't deny that Carter's smarts and relentless work ethic had put him on top. That, Aidan could respect. Besides, Carter had always been a gamer. Had to be in order to survive, coming from the background he came from and floating in the circles he did, hobnobbing with those born with silver spoons when he'd barely had plastic. Not that the corporate life was one Aidan would choose, and that was a sore spot for him and his father. And the fact that one of his best friends had stepped up to the business plate like the son his father never had should have really gotten under Aiden's skin. But somehow, it didn't, and he thought that bugged his father all the more. For all Aidan cared, Carter could take over the family business, at least the glad handing and the conference room bull, if his father would leave him alone to do the type of stories he felt were meaningful. cut him loose, and let him do the investigative work he loved, and stop trying to pull him off the streets and into the confines of a boardroom. His place was out in the real world, telling the stories of the people, not crunching numbers and trying to find the best way to pull in more ad revenue. Or worse, working on more projects like this on-air marriage sideshow. But Dad was the boss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.